Hello, my name is John Jenks and I am the director of the Hippopotamus. It's been a huge slog, about 10 years making this film, and to come here and to show it at the home of British cinema is really great. It's a real honour to be opening the festival, and a little bit of pressure. I really hope people like it. So there are really two issues with adapting the novel. First was that the novel is epistolary, and so all the action happens in letters reported in the book. And the second problem was that Stephen wrote it before the invention of Twitter, and therefore he hadn't learned to stick to 140 characters. And there are just constantly people walking in and out of rooms, and it's impossible. I really bonded with two of the main characters. Both the protagonist and the antagonist have stories that I can really relate to. I thought it was really funny, and obviously we're at a comedy festival and that corresponds quite well. But I saw within the novel that there was a strong plot structure, the sort of detective film that we're all used to seeing quite a lot of, that we could build the film around, and that could be used as something comfortable that people could keep coming back to, and then we could be as crazy as we want to be, because everyone could come back to this strong plot structure. And I think you need a strong plot like that to make a film really work. As his Twitter feed says, he is all alum. I never wanted anyone other than Roger. You know, I kept tried to be persuaded by money people that it would be easier to finance with someone other than Roger. I was told by, if we could just put this together, we can package it in a different way. And no, we had to stick with Roger because he is the only person who could have had the comedy and the engagement of pulling off those lines, but also, you know, the incredible bathos that he can bring to a character that I really only think could have been him.
Hi, my name is Roger Allam. I play Ted Wallace in The Hippopotamus.
How does it feel to not just be sharing this film, but to be opening the Loco Festival as well?
Fantastic. I mean, it's wonderful that the film has got that opportunity, and I'm really looking forward to seeing it again. Hopeless drunk poet, ex-theatre critic Ted Wallace finds himself going to the country house of a friend and also of his nephew to try and solve a mystery. And the mystery, he doesn't know what it is first, but the mystery becomes apparent as the film and the story progress.
What was it about that story and about this character that most excited you as a performer?
I completely loved the character, I have to say. A scurrilous old Soho poet, what could be better? The character of Ted is in a way Stephen's mouthpiece, and so you have to find a way of doing... I mean, Stephen has the most extraordinary vocabulary, should I say. Can I say? Yes, I can. And knows how to use it. And so I suppose you have to find a way of doing that in film, which is something of a challenge, but a very interesting one.
It's an absolutely fantastic cast alongside you, and I know you spent a lot of time particularly working with the young Emily Barrington. Can you talk about those experiences for you?
Well, we had a wonderful time, really. You know, our main location was West Wickham House, which is the most beautiful sort of, not exactly a stately home, but a kind of party home of the 18th century. It was just a really, really, really pleasant experience being there all the time with a wonderful cast of people, some of whom I knew, like Tim McInerney, Fiona Shaw, who were old friends, and others that I didn't, but met there.
What are you hoping an audience overall takes away from this film when they get a chance to enjoy it for themselves?
Well, I hope they have a really, I hope they find it funny, but I hope they also find it moving, because it's one of those stories in which the characters change very much through their experiences, through the story, and I hope the audience does too.
Oh, it's, I mean, it's a wonderful honour to be opening the festival. It's an amazing thing. I mean, I'm a big fan of the BFI. I'm a member and all that kind of stuff. So anything that they do, I approve of. But choosing this film just proves what great taste they have. I think I just love the script. And I mean, I love the character as well. I mean, it was... I knew that Roger was going to be doing it. I knew Fiona was going to be doing it. And I just thought, I haven't played anything like this before. Certainly not on screen. And it made me laugh. Well, he's a theatre director. So this is my revenge on theatre directors. He's fantastically camp. It's not my subtlest performance, but then that's kind of not the point. I mean, that's what he is. I mean, and actually, speaking to Stephen Fry about it, he thought it was amazing how much I'd toned it down from the original novel. So, it was. I mean, that was one of the things for doing it. Really, was that it was just such great fun. I mean, he's not well, and he wants to be cured. He also wants to be taken seriously. He hasn't had a hit for a while. But he's also the life and soul of the party. He tells lots of extremely rude stories. Well, Stephen is... I mean, he is probably the most intelligent person I've ever met. But that's... I'd better say, apart from Richard Curtis, otherwise I'll get into trouble. But I think the main thing about Stephen, the main thing that makes him extraordinary is that he is genuinely interested in every single person he ever meets, of whatever strata of society or whatever job they have or whatever age they are. And I think that's what makes him a good writer as well. I mean, that he genuinely wants to bring his own view of everybody's experience onto a page or into a screenplay. I mean, he wants everybody to share his view of the world, which is multifaceted, and it's remarkable. And I think he succeeds a lot in doing that. I'm in the middle of something at the moment, which is. I've been rehearsing, because that's what you do. I've been rehearsing the new Mike Lee film. So I finished doing that, and I start shooting it in 3 weeks' time, which is very exciting.
Hi, my name is Lynn Renee. It's a privilege. It really is, and I'm very excited to be here and to attend. I haven't even seen the film, so I'm very curious. I don't think she fits in at all, and that's, I think, the beauty about her character. And she comes in, and she's desperately always trying to find her place everywhere, but is failing to do so. But, you know, she's French, and she comes in, and she's had a obviously completely different upbringing than, you know, the British mentality. But it was a beautiful clash, I would say, and it was very fun to work with that and the accent and to, you know, find surprises in, for example, when I named the horse Lilac instead of Lilac, and it kind of happened spontaneously, and then the director was like, keep it that way, it works perfectly. It was a great experience because, you know, he was able to let us free and come in with our own sense of thought of how I saw the character, and he just came to us after a take and would say something that was so subtle but made such sense and would guide me in the right direction of performing the next scene. It was a little daunting in the beginning to be working with a cast of that, you know, grandeur. It was just, you know, you feel the theatre background, and it was very poetic, and we had a lot of table sequences that we shot, and I think we've had most fun at that. At one point, you know, during the setups and the light changes, we were at the table for an entire day, and actors would fall asleep at the table, and the whole running gag had become that for us to take pictures of the sleeping actors around the table. But working with Roger and Fiona, I mean, how lucky can you to get with, you know, actors like that? You learn so much from them, and you know, it's just been absolutely amazing. I think his voice, I think we respected his voice a lot because, as you said, you know, Stephen Fry is someone who has a very specific way of writing. And I don't think it's that easy to make an adaptation. But we succeeded in doing so and really stuck to, I don't know if I can say rules, but you, I think there are the rules. And when you read him, the characters came dancing off the pages, and I can only hope that we, you know, gave him credit and that we were able to, that we were able to, I'm lacking my words now, but visualize his writing, and I do believe that we succeeded, if I may. I'm going to be playing Anna in Deep State. It's a new TV series for Fox and BBC. I'll be playing Mark Strong's wife, which I'm really excited about because I'm a great fan of his work. And I can't wait. So we're starting to shoot in June, so it's coming up soon. For me, it's going to be a challenge to play something and a character that is going to be completely different than what I have played before. So I'm really looking forward to it. I love challenges.
Hi, I'm Tommy Knight. I'm playing David Logan in The Hippopotamus, and we're here at the BFI South Bank today to give it a watch.
Why do you think it's especially important to have events like this that celebrate particular genres of cinema?
The amount of genres there are so diverse. Some people like one thing, some people like another, you know. Like, I'm not so much a fan of romance myself, but horrors and comedies, I'm so there. So other people who are more into your romances and things, having a special day for them, it's like you can go and you can share the experience with people who are right behind, you know, right there with you in those like romantic bits or in those horror moments, and are so excited to be there. That's why it's so important to have, you know, like a festival to celebrate a genre. David's an interesting child. He's born into a very wealthy family. He's very kind, very sensitive soul. Big fan of his uncle's poetry in general. So he reads a lot of Wordsworth, reads a lot of the greats like White and that. He's a little bit slightly deluded, you could say, but adorable, I like to think. He's a nice guy. Working with some of the people has been incredible. Roger Allam is quite an inspiration to me. He was telling me a lot about some of the work he's doing with graduate students. He works with acting students and things. And so I was talking about the sort of development that he does with them, and just some sort of interesting techniques, the way they discuss work together and things. Really taught me a lot about my way to approach my job. It was really nice, really, really nice for me. It was so nice to work with Fiona Shaw, because personally, I worked with her. My first ever job, I was five, and worked at the Queen's Theatre on Shaftesbury Avenue. We did the play Medeo, and I was five together. She murdered me like 60 times. And so seeing her, I haven't seen her for ages. And when we saw each other, she remembered, I remembered. It was a really nice little greeting. And I'm a big Tim McInerney fan, so that was obviously incredible. My best memory on set was shooting we had a day on a lake where I was rowing a boat, and I got to spend the day learning how to row the boat around, and it was really beautiful. Like the set that we had, the house we were in, was so pretty and so tranquil. It was a really nice day to learn how to row the boat. It was just me and Roger in a boat all day, just chatting. Great. Currently working on season 2 of ITV's Victoria. I'm playing young Master Brody, the King's valet.
What can fans expect from season 2?
Just exactly the same, as good, as beautiful, just the same stuff. Yeah, it's so nice, consistent.
How does it feel to be kicking off this year's festival?
It feels amazing. I can't believe that we get to go first, and especially when I saw what else is coming on over the next few days, I'm really, really proud that we're first. It's hard to give a synopsis because it's so sort of beautifully rich and complicated, but it's basically about a poet played by Roger Allam, who is asked by his goddaughter, me, to go and investigate a mystery that's happening at a house called Swafford Hall. He's very cynical, and the things that he encounters there kind of challenge his way of thinking. So Jane is an interesting character in that she looks at life in a very sort of whimsical and imaginative way. She's travelled, she's very into yoga, she's kind of lives on another planet in some ways, and that's what made me really want to play her. She's a very entertaining character, and she's also incredibly rigid in her beliefs. And so that's where the story begins, with her being absolutely convinced that this miracle has happened to her, and wanting Roger's character to go and find out what that is. Well, I think the thing that initially excited me was that the book was written by Stephen Fry. I'm a huge fan of his. I hadn't read this novel, but I'd read some of his others. So I immediately thought it will definitely be really funny, really whimsical and clever, and that's exactly what it is. And then the screenplay adaptation was so brilliant. And then I heard he was cast, and I'm a huge fan of Roger Allam, so it was everything, really. I mean, he was everything I sort of wanted him to be. From having watched him so much in things like The Thick of It, I was just thrilled that he was just as sort of brilliant and entertaining and generous and nice to work with. I had a very complex scene with him where I had to deal with about 1,000 props, kind of more props than any actor has ever had to use in one scene. And he was very kind at putting me at ease and reassuring me every time I dropped the cigarette or kicked over a glass. He would sort of, really handle it with a great sense of humour. There's a scene where I have to do the entire scene standing on my head. And that was pretty difficult, just in terms of how bizarre it was. Just spent half a day. I was doing a sort of yoga headstand, which I actually can't do in real life. So just out of shot, there was one of the crew members holding my feet so that I was still. And often kind of a whole take would go to waste just because I was laughing about how bizarre it was, which would mean I then had to just go back on my head and do it again. So I was kind of my own worst enemy. I read it as soon as I was casting it, and it didn't disappoint at all. But I absolutely loved Stephen Fry's book, The Liar. And it had a kind of similarity in its intelligence. The humour in it is really clever, really witty. So I read it straight away, and it was great because it sort of immediately gave me loads more about my character, her, even physically, her description of her. And actually, they've stayed quite true to the novel in the screenplay. The two screenwriters really have kept... I think they've kept some actual, lines from the novel, and then also just enhanced it in different ways to make it work for screen. So I think anyone that liked the novel already will also really like the screenplay. Well, it's a brilliant combination of being very intelligent, but also a lot of the comedy, and definitely language is kind of down in the gutter, so it's got something for everyone, I would say. And it's I don't think we would pretend it's sort of hard to grasp. I think that there's a lot of intelligence in the comedy and in the characters, but it's something that on a comedic level everybody will enjoy. So I've just finished filming a BBC miniseries called The Miniaturist, in which I play the miniaturist. And then so that should be out around Christmas time. Mm. So it's a fantastic cast of really amazing women, particularly Romola Garai, Hayley Squires, Anya Taylor-Joy, Paprasiadu. It's an absolutely brilliant cast set in Amsterdam in the 1600s about a woman who gets married and then starts to be sent very strange little miniature objects that appear to be telling her about her future. And it was a book I'd already read because I collect miniature things. And so when this thing came up that was about miniature objects, everybody bought me the book. And so when the project came up, I just thought, I've got to be in that. I've absolutely got to be in it. It's historical. It's also slightly eerie. It's kind of an eerie period drama, I would say. It'll be perfect, cozy nights by a fire, Christmas watching, I think. We will be doing Humans again. We'll be filming sometime later this year, and so it'll be out sometime next year. Sadly, I don't know a single thing about the plot. I saw the writers the other day, and they had all these post-it notes everywhere, and I was sort of trying to look for my character name on them, but didn't see anything. I'm just so glad we get to not only tell the next bit of the story, but that I will get to find out the next bit of the story. I mean, if we hadn't got a third series, I would have made them write it just for me to read, I think, because I'm dying to see what will happen to the world now that every synth is conscious. I mean, I hope they've got a huge budget because we're going to need a lot of synth supporting actors.
Obviously, season two was a massive expansion on the first season. I guess my final question, obviously you don't know what's going to happen in season three, but particularly for your character and just in general, are there areas that you'd really like to explore, things that you think would be interesting to get to play with?
Well, I really hope that Niska and Astrid's relationship gets to continue and develop. I thought that was a really interesting side of Niska, being quite hard in many ways and seeing her being romantic and loving and soft. But what I'm really interested to see is how humans react to what is now an entirely conscious new race of synths.